So I've been sitting here, typing away, trying to come up with the words for this script. I sure don't have any lack of thoughts or opinions on the matter that I'm gonna discuss, but articulating those into a coherent and informative video is harder than sometimes people on YouTube might lead you to believe, through their talent. Chances are that if you've read the title, you're probably asking yourself, what glimpse could Quarian society give us of our future? A spacefaring one? A future with AI helpers and ever-increasing automation? Well, you would be correct in those assumptions, as it seems we are certainly headed that way. But due to recent events, a more troubling notion has presented itself, refusing to back down. However, to fully explore this, and to better showcase my point, we have to travel back in time. A time where an entire sci-fi universe is about to capture the hearts and minds of many people. A time where, much like in-game, we were meant to explore. A time to begin anew. The date is November 17th, 2007, and many people across the world pick up their first copy of Mass Effect 1. As you pick up your own copy, you drive home, power up the console, pop the disc in, and start a new game. Hours are spent on customizing Shepard and getting through the first mission. As every minute passes, this universe starts opening itself up, showing you what this galaxy is all about. You learn about all the different species, their stories, their heritage, and their roles. You learn about the technology that's used, the history between all of the races on display, and you do all this by just playing. But with that being said, I don't think I'm alone in stating that what Mass Effect 1 did was nothing short of amazing. The amount of detail they reveal to you through the characters, the art design, the dialogue is just astounding. It is my belief that given enough care, the Mass Effect universe could rival the likes of giants like Star Wars and Star Trek. For a while, the future of Mass Effect was full of possibility, getting two incredible sequels. Sequels which further explored and explained even more aspects of this universe. Now, regardless of what the future might hold for this franchise, we got to experience a hell of a trilogy, and no matter what happens, this universe will always be out there. It might lie dormant, it might be forgotten like an ancient ruin on an uncharted planet, but its metaphors, its warnings, and its motifs will persist. But ultimately, one of the aspects I want to highlight is that almost all of the races in Mass Effect are a dramatization of various aspects of our own species, and it really doesn't take long for one to realize this. You can successfully pinpoint and point out the most defining traits of each race with 1 to 3 words. The Krogan, for instance, are warlike, brutish, and tribal, whereas the Turians are industrious, militaristic, and proud. And you could go on to describe all of the other races in the same fashion. Now, these descriptions are what some might call stereotypes, and they could very well be. But what you have to remember is that Mass Effect, at the end of the day, is a journey of discovery through humanity's eyes. Of course, we know that these species are written this way because it helps the writing staff for each project to have a few key features on the back of their minds when they go on to create characters and story arcs. You also have to take into account the fact that even if you try to make up a race that felt unique and nuanced, you would soon find that you just described mankind with perhaps a few different physical traits. This is because we only know of us, our lived experience through thousands of years of history. We are not capable, unfortunately, of conjuring up any concept that isn't at the very least based on a combination of concepts we have witnessed. Now, I want you to remember what I said earlier, that almost all the races in Mass Effect are a dramatization of several traits. This is because I believe the Quarians were given special attention when they were written. They, out of all the species, seem the most nuanced and psychologically diverse. Now, to understand this, we have to go to the Mass Effect wiki, and it says, "The Quarians are a nomadic species of humanoid aliens known for their skills with technology and synthetic intelligence. Since their homeworld Rannoch was conquered, the Quarians live aboard the Migrant Fleet, a huge collection of starships that travel as a single fleet. Approximately 300 years before the events of 2183, the Quarians created the Geth, a species of rudimentary AIs, to serve as an efficient source of manual labor. However, when the Geth gradually became sentient, the Quarians became terrified of possible consequences and tried to destroy their creations. The Geth won the resulting war and forced their creators into exile. Now the Quarians wandered the galaxy in a flotilla of salvaged ships, second-hand vessels, and recycled technology. Now in Mass Effect 2, during Tali's trial, you can engage in several conversations with three members of the Admiralty Board regarding the Geth. Han Garrel will advocate for the complete destruction of the Geth and the reclamation of Rannoch. Meanwhile, Zal'Koris reveals that peace may be the best option, in his opinion, while Darrow Zen wishes to re-establish complete control over the Geth once again. This kind of varied thought and different methods of approach to the same issue is akin to what you will find if you discuss a particular topic with different individuals in real life. And this is something that most races in Mass Effect do not show. Or at the very least, if some individuals do, they are portrayed as anomalies and oddballs. Having said all of that, I also find it necessary to read you an excerpt from the wiki regarding Quarian biology, which states the following. The most distinguishing feature of Quarian biology is their weak immune system, compounded by centuries of living in sterile environments. As a result, all Quarians by necessity dress in highly sophisticated virus suits to protect them from disease or infection if they are injured. Their suits can be compartmentalized in the event of a tear or similar breach to prevent the spread of contaminants similar to a ship sealing off bulkheads in the event of a hull breach. Along with their suits, Quarians also have extensive cybernetic augmentations integrated into their bodies. A Quarian's lifespan is roughly equal to a human's, but is prone to be less if infection breaks into the suit. Quarian immune systems have always been relatively weak, as pathogenic microbes were comparatively rare in the homeworld's biosphere. Furthermore, what few viruses and other microbes were native to the homeworld were often at least partially beneficial to them, giving them a symbiotic relationship with their environment. After living aboard a migrant fleet for generations, the Quarian's immune systems have atrophied further still due to years in the sterile environment of the migrant fleet. As such, Quarians are given various vaccinations and immunizations to help ward off disease. However, they prefer the safety of their suits even in clean environments, and are reluctant to remove them without a good reason. A Quarian who wishes to remove their suit must take antibiotics, immunoboosters, herbal supplements, or the like to do so safely, and even then there are inherent risks. As a result, physical acts of affection are difficult for Quarians even for the purposes of reproduction. Ships in the migrant fleet often contain clean rooms where Quarians can give birth or undergo medical procedures in relative safety, though there are always risks. The most intimate thing Quarians can do is link their suit environments. However, doing so guarantees a Quarian will get sick, although they will usually adapt over time. I bet right about now, all of this is sounding very familiar to us living in current times. Not because we are living in virus suits, but because of recent events, there is an ever-increasing demand for more sterilization of public environments in order to prevent infection. And I'm by no means a medical professional, but from my limited understanding, lack of exposure to anything means that you'll become less adept at handling it. But that's not the most troubling parallel. You see, I suggest that the most troubling implication is the one about severe changes to their social dynamics. Just think about it. Isn't it harder to connect with anyone who has a mask on? I can tell you from personal experience that it affects communication and interpersonal behavior, be it in a professional, casual, or romantic context. And as far as I know, this is just when we are required to wear them in public. Imagine the huge mutations in societal norms we could come to witness if we start wearing them in a more personal setting. Now, it has only been a year since it all started, so it's still much too early to draw any conclusions. But without the power of hindsight, we can only speculate. Through conversations with people in real life, I have also found a different perspective, one that I don't agree with. This is the notion that all of this is just part of evolution, and that we need to be more accepting of change. Ever since that point came to my attention, I cannot help but despise it, and yet, I still find myself contemplating it, judging if there's any validity to it. And amidst this, the new trailer dropped for the Legendary Edition. And when I saw Tali again, the idea was not as ridiculous as I thought it to be. Suddenly the idea that a whole species might choose to wear something artificial to prevent infection was not as outlandish as I had assumed. Although it has to be said that we have not followed the same evolutionary path as the Quarians did, due to vastly different biomes. But this does not mean that we might not end up in the same place, especially when you take into consideration our self-removal from the natural environment. And if you're doubting that we're so far removed from our natural environments already, just ask yourself, could you survive in nature with only your bare hands? To most of us, the most likely answer would be no, since growing crops, hunting, and harvesting for resources are skill sets no longer widely imparted in us. This is due to technology changing our lives beyond what could ever be imagined. Furthermore, it is my opinion that a technology-altered world and civilization was inevitable. Competition demands it. It demands the need for change, for innovation, and above all, adaptation. It demands you and yours must outnumber, outclass, outgun, and outthink the other group. It's a big part of what makes us the most dominant species in our planet, and as history has shown it over and over again, we might find ourselves in the Quarians' shoes, where much like in the real world, their current situation was victim of history being shaped by culture, and then their culture being shaped by their history. Thanks for watching.
So the Quarians won't have to wear those suits anymore?
It doesn't seem possible, but yes, in a few years, with Geth improvements, we won't need them. We might still wear them. The suits have become part of our society.